Okay, I think we'll start. It's an enormous pleasure to introduce this conference. It's a wonderfully conceived conference and wonderfully executed. And I can say that because it's a tribute to one of our PhD students, Sandra Ristovska. Is Sandra here? Hi, Sandra. So I think it's not exactly unique in the annals of Annenberg, but it's close to unique in terms of the energy and vision that Sandra brought to this, and both in terms of its conceptualization, its organization, and its execution. So today is a kind of a final tribute to the work that she's done in putting this together. It also arose in part from a Provost grant, which is a very lovely initiative by the Provost of the University of Pennsylvania to increase Annenberg's and the university's global reach. And I want to thank Amy Gadsden and a variety of other people for the Provost grant. The sponsors have included the Annenberg School for Communication, the School of Social Policy and Practice, the Scholars Program in Culture and Communication, Perry World House, Cinema Studies, Camra, which is another unique contribution that the various people here are involved in, Comparative Literature and the Center for Media, Data, and Society at the Central European University, as well as the American Austrian Foundation. So it's taken a lot of small pieces to put this enterprise together. And again, Sandra's very loving and generous in nourishing all of these various pieces. A number of Penn faculty supported our application and have been very supportive in generally. They include, of course, our wonderful dean, Michael Deli Carpini, John Jackson, our faculty member and dean of SP2, William Burke White, Barbie Zelizer, Brendan O'Leary, Eileen Doherty Sill, Peter DeCherney and Rahul Mukherjee, Kevin Platt, Deborah Thomas, who's here, Nan Mayer, who's at, and others who I'm sure I've missed. I want to also single out Marwan Crady, who will become the director of the Center for Global Communication Studies in May, and who's I think he's here. He may be here, but he's been very, very supportive. And I want to provide a shout out to Kyle Cassidy, who's been the steadfast documenter of events at Cardozo and events in the life of the Center for Global Communication Studies, and who's here today. Speaking of photography, one unusual aspect of this conference is our cooperation with Moving Walls, which is a project of the Open Society Foundation. They commission photography around the world of significance on conflict and visuality. And there will be selected photographs from their exhibitions shown on the panel here during coffee and lunch breaks at this conference. You should have a handout which has the names of the photographers. Finally, I want to thank the devoted staff of the Center for Global Communication Studies, which has really held this center together and has worked very painstakingly to make this conference and so many other things possible. And we have Briar Smith, Laura Schwartz-Henderson, Alexander Essenler, and our newest addition, Ariel, wherever she is. So anyway, thanks to all of you for coming, and it's a great team, and we think of you as part of this. So thanks a lot.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mariam Durrani. I am the moderator for the first panel, titled Images, Trauma, and Memories. We're beginning the conference with presentations that consider how images of tragic moments in human history can be excavated to understand trauma more deeply and how public memory is constructed in four diverse international contexts. We will be hearing from an interdisciplinary group of scholars, filmmakers, and human rights practitioners about how we can understand visual media to tell stories more ethically and in just ways. So the first speaker is Dr. Sharon Slawinski, and a little bit about her. She is the Associate Professor in the Faculty of Media and Information Studies at the University of Western Ontario. Dr. Slowinski's book, Human Rights in Camera, traces the visual constitution of human rights from the 18th century through the aftermath of World War II, and she is currently working on a project about the politics of dream life and has a forthcoming book called Dream Matters, Six Exercises in Political Thought, coming in 2016. Her presentation today, Precarious Evidence, One Photograph from Northern British Columbia, begins and ends with a single photograph. Please.
Will it be obvious how I get the technology up? It was called Visual Art. Here it is. Can I tap on it? Great, thank you. It's okay. I have very low tech, so it's not a huge problem.
You're fine with this?
That's fine. Good morning. Thank you, Sandra, for all your work and the rest of the team. Thank you, Professor Price and the Annenberg School. It's always a thrill. I never get tired of the thrill of being asked to talk about one's work. I know we don't have a lot of time, so a very short preamble. Like many of the police forces in this country, we have a problem in our country, too. I'm a Canadian. It's going to be a Canadiana talk. I never do this. Our national police force, the RCMP, the Royal Mounted Canadian Police, or the Mounties, you probably know them from their red serge. There's been a number of bad television shows. Our police forces have a race problem, too. In Canada, we've discovered the ways in which racism can land with great violence upon the body. In the RCMP's case, the target has been overwhelmingly Aboriginal bodies. And so the talk today is a little piece of a larger and a very much slow-moving, ongoing project about the ways in which sexual violence is sutured to questions of sovereignty. And I'm trying to think through the kind of problems that sexual violence offers for thinking about visual culture. It's not easily represented. Okay. Photographs are good for thinking, bonne pensée, as Claude Lévi-Strauss might have said. My paper begins and ends with a single photograph. Here you can see it. Taken in an undisclosed town in northern British Columbia in 2012 by Megan Rode, a senior researcher for the Women's Rights Division of Human Rights Watch. The photograph is good for thinking, by which I mean it asks its spectators to undertake a particular kind of work, a psychological labor that is not only about engaging ideas, but more akin to a digestive process, a working through of difficult knowledge. The photograph allows us to make contact with a human rights crisis that is still unfolding in northern British Columbia, and in so doing obliges spectators to digest the untamed thoughts that surround this scene. More specifically, and here's my leitmotif, this photograph asks us to think, which is to say, to digest the sexual scene that lies at the heart of sovereign power. Rhodes' photograph was published in a 2013 Human Rights Watch report with a long title called Those Who Take Us Away, Abusive Policing and Failures of Protection of Indigenous Women and Girls in Northern British Columbia. It is one of 17 photographs included in the report, most of which were taken by Samer Muscati, another Human Rights Watch researcher. And you probably have noticed that Human Rights Watch reports are getting more and more visual as time goes on. Several of the pictures that the researchers took during their six-week investigation could not be published without compromising the safety of the women and girls in question. These photographs belong to a category we might name unshowable. Despite the increasingly banal claim that our contemporary media landscape is overwhelmed with a flood of images, there are any number of documents that remain unshowable. These are photographs that we cannot see or share in the ubiquitous language of social media, precisely because of their coiled force. We should not lose sight, however, of what these images continue to ask us to think. Built from research conducted in 10 towns across northern BC, the Human Rights Watch report chronicles the relationship between the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, the RCMP, and Indigenous women and girls who live in this region. The report offers evidence for the ways the police have failed to protect this population from violence, but perhaps more importantly, it documents cases in which the police have been the chief perpetrators of this violence. The report contributes to a growing collection of evidence documenting the ongoing forms of abuse committed against Aboriginal women and girls in Canada. The Native Women's Association has been at the forefront of this battle, tirelessly documenting cases of murdered and missing women, as has Justice for Girls, a Vancouver-based civil rights organization who first petitioned Human Rights Watch to investigate the situation in northern BC. The crisis has also drawn the attention of the international community. Apart from Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International has conducted an investigation, as has the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and more recently, even the UN has become involved, conducting an investigation under the auspices of their Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. Despite the growing spotlight on this issue, the Human Rights Watch report is the only extended independent investigation of police violence in the northern part of this province. The report relays accounts of young girls being pepper sprayed and tasered, a 12-year-old being attacked by a police dog, a 17-year-old being repeatedly punched by an officer who was called to help her, women being strip searched by male officers, women being injured due to excessive force during arrest, and on and on. The most disturbing allegations, however, concern rape and other forms of sexual assault. The human rights researchers gathered testimony about police officers raping women in 5 of the 10 towns they visited, and just recently, within the last few months, it turns out they're also doing it in Quebec, so it's like a Canadian world problem. One of the most disquieting testimonies is from an Indigenous woman who is given the pseudonym Gabriella. She describes how in July 2012, RCMP officers picked her up off the street, took her outside of town, raped her, and threatened to kill her if she told anyone, warning her that they could make it look like an accident. Human Rights Watch photographed the remote location where the rape occurred based on Gabriella's description. When the researchers later showed her these photographs, she reacted with distress and recounted more details of the incident. The organization declined to publish these images in order to protect Gabriella's safety. They note that there's a disturbingly acute fear of exposure and retaliation from the police in this region. The report also situates this contemporary sexual violence within a historical context, as the police force of jurisdiction in many areas where Indian residential schools were located in BC. In Canada, we tried to destroy Aboriginal people by taking them out of their home, the kids out of their homes, and putting them in a residential school system that effectively excised their culture from them. We're still kind of working through the traumatic residues of this. The cops helped remove Indigenous children from their homes and return truants to the schools, often by force. There's an ongoing debate about the RCMP's complicity in the abuses that occurred in these schools. The title of the Human Rights Watch report is drawn from the carrier word for police, the language that's spoken in this region, which translates literally as those who take us away. But this is where we're talking about, by the way. The Highway 16, I don't know if you can see it, is now often referred to as the Highway of Tears because there's so many Aboriginal kids that go missing on this when they're hitchhiking across this highway. We're beginning to grasp the ways that trauma involves an unconscious structure, which is actualized and transmitted intergenerationally. We know, in a certain manner of speaking, that the historical violence of past lives lives on in the generations that follow. But the inherited memory traces of these abuses are not just carried by the survivors. We do not yet know enough about the ways that the structure of this trauma, or more precisely, the pre-structure, is carried and transmitted by the perpetrators. It bears pointing out, of course, that policing is a family profession. The primal scene that continues to unfold in northern BC undoubtedly has its roots in this living history. For several years, the RCMP has sidestepped report after report from international organizations showing a disturbing indifference to criticism. In response, for example, in response to the Human Rights Watch report, the chief of the RCMP who sent out an email to his colleagues saying, you know, don't worry about this report, don't let it impede your work. They're sort of spectacularly resistant to responding to any kind of criticism. Okay, so we have a profoundly fraught situation. The precarious evidence that we do possess of systematic abuse being perpetuated by the police is being concertedly denied and even repressed. What are we to do? I'm going to pose a rather low-tech answer. I'm sorry to disappoint on that matter. Rather than work to improve the evidence I think we should need to improve the way we work with the evidence that we do have. So let me come back to Megan Rhodes' photograph. The picture shows an anonymous community worker displaying several pairs of underwear to the camera. Sometimes I count 9, sometimes 11. As the report describes, a community worker distributes underwear to women on the street as part of her work. She does this because the women she encounters have been raped by the police, who then confiscate their underwear. Distressing questions arise. Do the police take the underwear because they know it may contain evidence of the sexual assault? Or do they steal the clothing as some kind of perverse trophy? The answers are surely significant, but either way, this community worker has learned from experience. She knows to bring clean underwear with her when she goes out onto the street. The photograph entreats spectators to learn from this experience too. It asks us to try to digest the nature of this crude political anatomy, the way sovereign power is brokered across and through women's bodies. This photograph represents a particularly fragile form of human rights evidence in this respect. It can only perform its work by bringing, or luring, I should say, the spectator into imagining the scene that precedes this picture, and by demanding that we tolerate the emotional force of this imagining, scenes that are, of course, nowhere to be seen in the photograph. In order to know, we must imagine for ourselves, Georges Didi Huberman has insisted in relation to a rather different set of images. I think we too are implored to imagine for ourselves the hell that is the dark streets of Prince George in BC, to imagine what takes place in jail cells and in the backs of police cars, indeed all along Highway 16, the Highway of Tears. We are entreated to imagine for ourselves what rape does to a young person's body and mind. Apart from the bruised and bloodied flesh, the wet left between women's legs, we're invited to imagine how this act can install a state of social death inside a living human being, exiling a person from her own body and engendering a total collapse of spirit, in Marcia Crosby's powerful words, shattering the very capacity for trust in a shared and shareable human condition. The photograph asks us to imagine all this for ourselves. It does this work quietly. There's no spectacle of suffering pictured here. But it nevertheless managed to bring us closer to the primal scene that lies at the heart of sovereign power. Or more accurately, the photograph entreats us to begin to regard this scene as central to sovereignty's plot. To be clear, I'm suggesting that such photographs and the scenes which they entreat us to imagine can be understood as evidence of a grave crime, a crime that has been concertedly repressed. In the utter absence of any reliable standards of reality, in this case, we must find new ways to work with the fragile materials that we do possess. Our collective acts of imagination can serve as one of our most potent tools, a kind of counter-dispositif that will help bring these crimes further into the light. The particular fragility of the evidence presented in this Human Rights Watch report, evidence that is at times both unshowable and unverifiable, quickens a series of questions that might transform our thinking about human rights crises. As it turns out, the abstract nakedness of being nothing but human, as Hannah Arendt famously phrased it, is not so abstract at all. Which is to say, it is not only the loss of a political community that can cut off a human being's access to the human condition. Rhodes' photograph helps us understand that there's a much more intimate and largely non-visible strategy that sovereign power has at its disposal to cleave a subject from their capacity to live a human life, namely by attacking the individual's claim to her own body, and specifically by targeting her sexual integrity, the individual's sense of sovereignty over her own body. The violence does its work in part by installing a sense of shame, by attacking the individual's core capacity to form a stable and coherent bodily ego, by shredding the subject's very capacity to form an internal sense of themselves as a subject worthy of dignity and rights. We have much yet to learn about this more intimate dimension of human rights and about how visual images can help us shape a response. Thank you.
Thank you for that very powerful paper. So the next speaker is...
I'm sorry. I'm sorry if you want to announce the next speaker.
The next speaker is Dr. Deborah Thomas. She is a professor here at Penn in the Anthropology Department and the Department of Africana Studies. Dr. Thomas's most recent book was titled Exceptional Violence, Embodied Citizenship in Transnational Jamaica, and it's part of a larger research project that she's been doing in Jamaica for several years. Her presentation today, Visual Witnessing, Affect Repair, and Afro-Diasporic Counterpublics, focuses on the 2010 Tivoli Gardens incident, where at least 75 civilians were murdered in the Jamaican state's effort to extradite individual Christopher Koch. Dr. Thomas asks us how we may approach visual archives as a form of witnessing designed to offer counter-narratives to state violence.
Thank you, Mariam. Thank you, Monroe and Sandra and everybody else. How can we confront the unpredictable afterlives of colonialism and slavery, nationalism and state formation in ways that perform not only a material but also an affective transformation? How do we address the question of what it means to be a human capable of acting in and on a world that hides the ontological entanglements of the violences that have been foundational to its formation? What does sovereignty feel like? These are the questions that have been haunting me as I've been working on my current project, which, as Martin told us, is an investigation into the 2010 extradition of Christopher Dodis Koch to the U.S. to stand trial here for gun and drug running charges. During the week of May 24th, members of the police force and the army entered the West Kingston community of Tivoli Gardens by force to apprehend Christopher Dodis Koch, who had been ordered for extradition in August 2009. At that point, Bruce Golding, who was the Prime Minister at the time, as well as the Member of Parliament for West Kingston, argued against the extradition on the procedural grounds that the evidence against Koch was obtained by wiretapping, which is illegal under Jamaican law. But by the third week in May, under pressure from Parliament and the US government, Golding announced to the nation on television that he had authorized the Attorney General to sign the extradition order. And this led to a standoff between the security forces that had to find Koch and many of Koch's supporters who were bent on protecting him at any cost. By the end of the week, Koch had not yet been found, and at least 75 civilians were officially recognized as having been killed, and the number that community members give is closer to 200. The government established a curfew for Tivoli Gardens, and residents were forced to show passes when leaving or entering. Most movement in or out of the community was effectively stopped, which meant that many people were unable to work, to go to school, to shop for food, or to go about the ordinary routines of their lives. This continued until June 22nd, when Koch was detained and subsequently extradited. And despite the immediate activities of various civil society organizations, it took almost 3 years for the Office of the Public Defender to submit a report to Parliament regarding the conduct of the security forces. And while a commission of inquiry is currently underway, a list of the dead has still not been released, and community members still feel their stories haven't been fully heard. Since 2010, we've been working with Tivoli Gardens community members, as well as a few people living in nearby communities, to create a film and multimedia installation that provide platforms through which they can recount their experiences during that May and June, and also name and publicly memorialize loved ones they lost. Through their narratives of state violence, in conjunction with additional visual and textual materials, we hope to evoke the affective entanglements these forms of violence reflect and produce, and to imagine how we might envision justice and political futures. Scholars and activists alike have long remarked on the importance of visual culture in drawing attention to events understood as humanitarian crises. In some contexts, the visual creates an intimacy that helps to generate response and moral feelings among viewers. In others, however, such as among African diasporic populations, visual archives have been used to pathologize or have been mobilized as techniques of surveillance and classification. The Caribbean region in particular has been represented and thus also categorized and classified as natural landscape, untouched by the human labor early observers erased from view. For planters, travel writers, and later tourism promoters, the region has been both picturesque and playground, virgin and peopled, seductive and sensational, all terms that erase the foundational violence of plantation slavery and colonial underdevelopment. Given the complex dynamics at play with respect to visuality in relation to Black folk and diaspora, therefore, the important questions have had to do with how we document violence, literally, metaphorically, and symbolically, without reinscribing the violence of archival practice through the very act of witnessing. One way in which scholars have attempted to walk this fine line is by focusing on the realm of the everyday, and I think that's what comes out so beautifully in the photograph that you just gave us. If we place events, as Diana Taylor has argued, into conversation with the daily, non-eventful enactments of embodied practice, then we're compelled to focus on the messy entanglements that ground the exceptional, what Veena Das would call the routine and unmelodramatic repetitions of daily life. This kind of emphasis on quotidian, non-eventful practice informs many of the scholars interpreting photographic documentation and circulation within both the intimate spheres of the family and the public spheres of exceptional violence. It also provides a mechanism through which the exceptional and spectacular can be incorporated into the everyday, such as in paparazzi prom entrances in the Bahamas or the blinding light of dance hall videography in Jamaica, and these are both phenomena that Krista Thompson has been working on. For Thompson, the technologies of vernacular photography facilitate a spectacular visibility, her words, that demands a new form of participation in Black public spheres across diasporic locations at the same time as it transforms the violence of hypervisibility. Another way in which we might document violence without reproducing it is suggested by Ariella Azoulay, who understands photography as creating a civil contract that anchors a new understanding of political relationality. When discussing photographic witnessing, Azoulay uses the rubric of contract rather than those of empathy or compassion because she wants to conceptualize citizenship anew as a framework of partnership and solidarity among those who are governed, a framework that is neither constituted nor circumscribed by the sovereign, her quote. Here she's speaking particularly to the Israel-Palestine context, but this is also the kind of reorientation we want to compel, both among Jamaicans, given the social and political processes that have been foundational to modern political democracy, and more broadly between Jamaicans and other transnational actors whose entanglements go back to the genocidal processes that were foundational to the modern West. The purpose here is to make visible the various complicities that shape the sociocultural and political economic sphere in which exceptionally violent events become possible, and moreover, to dismantle the hegemony of visuality in Mirzoff's usage as a weapon for imperial authority. In our work, we've been bringing community residents into a recording studio where we have shot still photographs and filmed their narratives. And part of our intention is to create a different kind of archive of Tivoli Gardens than that which is more generally publicly available on YouTube, for example. And what I'm referencing here is the fact that most visual representations of garrison communities, and garrison communities are these downtown Kingston communities characterized by homogeneous voting practices and a kind of leadership sharing between a local don and an elected politician. And so the more common visual representation of these communities highlight the sensationalist dimensions of poverty and political violence, they become a kind of ghetto porn. This has had two important effects, the first of which is that the violence that occurs in these communities is seen as episodic and culturally derived, rather than the result of structural and institutionalized political decision-making over time. The second related effect is that most Kingstonians, and Jamaicans more generally, who do not live downtown in garrisons, have a difficult time imagining people who do as being fully human, and therefore possessing either individual or collective rights, or being able to imagine an alternative future. Indeed, a phrase that we commonly hear in the process of telling others in Jamaica about what we're doing, even those who have a long history of political progressivism, has been, there are no innocents in Tivoli. For those articulating this sentiment, the actions of the security forces during May 2010 were legitimate and necessary, not instances of extrajudicial violence. As a response to this hegemonic visuality, we have chosen to photograph those individuals who have agreed to work with us against a stark white background. We've done this in order to encourage audience members to focus on their words and their faces, to attempt to generate the intimacy, recognition, and acknowledgement that might create the kind of contract Azoulay envisions. We are not, in other words, creating trauma testimonies, but instead a sense of the dynamic space in which the trauma of exceptional violence is deeply contextualized at many levels of scale. Three kinds of narratives have dominated our archive: men who were taken out of their homes and terrorized by the security forces, women who lost sons, baby fathers, brothers, nephews, and families who were spared but who spent five terrifying days hiding under a table. But what I want to show you now, briefly, speaks more to life than to death, and therefore toward a broader attempt at recognition and collaboration. So at the end of this clip, you will meet Chinaman and Annette, both of whom are talking about siblings that they lost during the state of emergency in 2010. Chinaman's little brother was killed, execution style, in the arms of his stepfather. Where are we? And Annette's sister was killed as she attempted to leave her house and go to her church to spend time with other people who were already there. Now let us get to it. That's not what I meant to show you. All right, we'll just go there.
Man always there on my still, you know. It's a youth him love. Them youth don't know a bookworm. A video game. He my them kind of youth. The people that call the way that's, you know, nerds. I saw them on the road. And him, man, him, he's a youth him. But I say, man, a friend like that. He's not one of them man that we ever see a walk in a group. He's not no friend. If he meet somebody to talk to, he might go find me or he'll find his mother. Says, are you not really associated? You know? Or he just go inside with a book and he just read or he might play a video game. He might just that kind of person. Good youth, man.
The last togetherness we had, Pet birthday, she born there. The 28th of January, 1974. She was 36 years old. And her last birthday that she celebrated, the same 2010 January, she said she have a pool party. You know the baby pool, the plastic pool. She had that full of water and I went up, dressed as old. But I had on my bath suit under my clothes. And when I went, I took off my clothes and put on my cap, shower cap on my head, and chuck off in the pool. You know the pool came over because of how big I am. Chef said to get a photograph up because me turn up the thing.
Okay, so within the broader project, which has emerged from our work on this film and installation, as I said at the beginning, I've been trying to identify what sovereignty has felt like at particular moments. But it seems also worth asking what repair would feel like. And I've said repair here rather than reparation in order to mark a kind of shift in orientation. Repair would be practice-oriented and quotidian. It's non-eventful, deeply historical, and relational. Repair, like its nominal counterpart, urges us to interrogate the multiple scales of entanglement that have led us to where we are now. But where reparation seeks justice through the naming of names, the exposure of public secrets, and the articulation of chains of causality, repair looks for something else. It demands an active listening, a mutual recognizing, an acknowledging of complicity at all levels. The shift from reparation to repair index is another, from justice to affectability. And this is Denise Ferreira da Silva's term, One she uses to think through the ways popular responses to anti-Black state violence, like riots, like fires, demand a different kind of understanding, knowing, in her words, than those usually pursued juridically. Knowing at the limits of justice, she writes, as an ethico-political praxis, requires onto-epistemological accounts that begin and end with relationality, affectability, that do no more than to anticipate what is to be announced, perhaps a horizon of radical exteriority where knowing demands affection, intention, and attention. It's an unsettled horizon, this knowing, not a blueprint, where futures uncertainly couch, and where civil society is resituated through a recognition of the limits of justice within the terrain of liberal post-Enlightenment humanism. What kind of revolution would have had to have happened for this horizon to come into being? And what kind of work can this horizon do for us? How might we think of repair affectively without evacuating the possibility of politics? How do we generate archives of affectability and thus the recognition of complicity that are necessary to the project of repair? And what do these archives look like? Thanks.
Our last speaker today is Moses Crispus Okello. He is a conflict analyst with Intergovernmental Authority on Development in Eastern Africa, and he focuses on conflict early warning and response mechanisms in Ethiopia. In his paper today, titled Images of Conflict, Imaginings of Peace, Mr. Okello will draw on his personal and professional experience to illustrate how the process of visualizing transitional justice can turn into a process of empowering and disempowering victims, elevating perpetrators, and violating activists. His paper examines the transformative role of visualization in changing the perceptions and narratives of victims and victimization, policymaking, and the disposition of filmmakers. Mr. Okello.
My presentation is going to be in two parts. One, a video, rather a slideshow of pictures playing over there, and a reading that I'll be doing concurrently. Being an international diplomat, we've developed ways of distracting people. So the presentation over there is meant to detract you from the presentation itself. I think the other thing... So as a formality, I would like to start by thanking my fellow panelists and everybody else in the room, and to hope that by that, everybody feels sufficiently appreciated. Like I said, I'd intended to put together a combination of video and pictures drawing on my previous work, but when I was informed that we have 15 minutes, I realized we couldn't do it. So I decided I was just gonna write up stuff and read it for you. I will start this conversation with a few caveats, one being that I'm neither a journalist, nor a photographer, nor a communication specialist. My thing is more human rights, transitional justice, and conflict analysis. And I'll also be doing this from the perspectives of an academic, sort of a practitioner, not an academic, so my take is slightly different on quite a few of the issues. As noted earlier, my presentation draws on over 15 years of work on the conflict in northern Uganda, and also on the experiences creating a national memory and peace documentation center in Uganda. In other words, this means the conversation that we're going to be having is really about nightmares from my past, and I hope, as the definition of transitional justice suggests, this could be useful in helping us to envision some form of a future. So first off, why is the presentation, which I believe is in your booklet, entitled Images of Conflict, Imaginings of Peace? Why didn't we just say this is a presentation on images of conflict? And I think the most important thing to take away from that title is that we were working at the time in a very specific political context, a context that was at the time very hostile to activism and therefore necessitated that in terms of the work that we did, we chose our language very carefully and presented images, which I think Deborah was referring to, images projecting the future rather than the past. But I mean, the truth is, even when we're projecting images of the future, what we're really doing is poking into what another colleague of mine refers to as the leftovers of war. So who are we talking about here? Just a little bit of context of the presentation. We're talking about a conflict, a two-decade-long conflict that took place between the Lord's Resistance Army and the government of Uganda. And it's in its wake, the usual violations that take place in conflict, of course, did take place. And here we're talking about murder, pillaging, rape, population displacement, and so on. But there were also atypical violations that took place, most notoriously the rape of men by the National Army. This was a very strategic weapon used by the army to break down the community. And the rape was not targeted at young people, it was targeted at community pillars. So this was a very unusual occurrence. So the question is, how then do you organize or undertake advocacy activities in a context where you have that nature of violations and a government that is hostile to activism? And here for us, and for the Refugee Law Project at the time, this is when we started experimenting with different modes of presentation. At the time, our focus was primarily on undertaking research and publishing, but we realized, just like Martinez said, many of the people that we were trying to reach out to could not read, and therefore there needed to be an alternative way of presenting presenting the story that we wanted, or at least the messages that we wanted the policymakers to take. And this brings me to my first point. Being an activist requires that we continuously adapt to our situation and deploy various capabilities, strategies, tactics, in order to break a real or perceived cycle of violence. Activism must be able to identify where in the wheel of conflict to place that cog in order to stop that cycle. With respect to the Refugee Law Process, Refugee Law Project, that process started, as I said, by shifting the focus, experimenting with videos, songs, displays of cultural artifacts, cartoons and pictures as mechanisms of sending the same message with different visual images. In a sense, we're shifting from a confrontational approach to a more conversational and dialogue-related one. Some of the tools that we used, for example, the artifacts, were, in our understanding, irrefutable embodiments of tangible memory, while others, for example, songs, transported the listeners to a particular zeitgeist that invoked particular memories that were useful in transforming conversations. But we also realized that by use of these images and tools, we were invoking legal responsibility among the powers that be, and catalyzing a process of engendering moral and political accountability, which at the time wasn't in the public discourse. The impact that we intended to achieve in the end was some modicum of reconciliation, with a hope that at some point Uganda would achieve a sustainable peace, having had a conflict in the cycle, or rather in the history of the country, since the colonial times. But we also knew that irrespective of whether we are drawing from the past or past facts, and here we distinguished facts from truths, or using fictional tools to anticipate a desired future, this process is fraught with challenges at the best of time. If it wasn't, why else would government be so interested in controlling processes of memory and visualization, particularly in a post-conflict context? Nevertheless, having deployed some of these tools, we realized a shift in the way the government was interacting with some of this material. Because for the first time, videos could actually give you a victim talking to their experiences, when a research paper could be very easily be discredited for having biased information. So this process of interaction between the government, you know, facilitated by the Refugee Law Project, allowed the discourse on transitional justice to shift, and for the first time, to start an actual national conversation around a policy that would help us to have a better understanding of the history of the country. But it also generated complex legal problems. For instance, some of the people we had projected in the videos could not neatly fall in the categories of either victim or perpetrator. So how do you then deal with that conundrum in a context where it's not very clear where to place somebody? And I think the most notorious character in this particular conversation is this chap they call Dominic Ongwen. For those of you who are following the proceedings in the International Criminal Court, you realize that there is a gentleman who is undergoing trial at the moment who was previously a child soldier abducted by the LRA and ended up being a commander. So there is a complexity there which emerged in the work that we're doing. The modes of communication, and I think Deborah referred to this, were also diverse. The modes of communicating these products were diverse. We did screenings for government officials, primarily senior government, but we also targeted diplomats. The idea with targeting diplomats was intended to provide a backup for us in terms of the work that we were doing. But we also did community screenings. And with respect to community screenings, as I mentioned earlier on, the issue of the rape of men became very, very notorious. Because for the first time, when we showed a video of one particular gentleman who had been sodomized, his story provoked quite a number of other people in the community to come out and start talking about their own experiences. And therefore, for the first time in about two decades, we had a mass of close to 70 or so people who were saying, it happened to me as well. But they also, the community process has also generated particular difficult questions. And again, reparations was being referred to here, but with respect to these men, one of the questions that they kept on asking is, should we start a transitional justice process in a formal one? How are you going to repair the crime of sodomy? And he related it to this, to the cultural process of paying dowry. Some of the gentlemen were asking, are you then going to pay me dowry, just like we pay men? Because what you did to me was what you'd normally do to women. The other dimension to that particular conversation related to the general homophobic context of Uganda. Uganda is a very homophobic country. So how do men start talking about their experiences in a context where people don't quite understand that being sodomized is quite different from being a homosexual? So that conversation also came out quite strongly from the community screenings. Which brings me to my second point, which I would like to illustrate. I wanted to illustrate by drawing on that video that most of you would know, Kony 2012, that was done sometime in March 2012. And this particular video, as you will know, went viral, perhaps only rivaled by the other one from Korea, Gangnam Style. But it generated quite a bit of a discourse in Uganda. A colleague of mine summarized the video, and I'm trying to rush through this thing here, summarized it as such. As a result of invisible children's irresponsible advocacy, civilians in Uganda and Central Africa may have to pay a steep price in their own lives so that a lot of young Americans can feel good about themselves and a few can make some good money. This, of course, is sickening, And I think that Kony 2012 is a case of invisible children having gone too far. There are so many facing, they are now facing a backlash from people of conscience who refuse to abandon their capacity to think. Kony 2012 and the debates around it are not about Uganda, but about America. Uganda is largely just the stage for a debate over the meaning of political activism in the US today. Likewise, in my view, and I conclude that quote, in my view, Kony 2012 campaign itself is basically irrelevant in Uganda, and perhaps the best approach to deal with it might be to just ignore it. And this for me just captures the sense at the time. Since I've got very little time left, I'll go to the last point, which is something about the author of Kony 2012. You realize that he broke down almost immediately after that video went viral. So the question then here is, what happened to him? Even if there was a lot of criticism coming up, what happened that changed his psychological disposition? This is the question about how certain forms of activism violate the activists. So in my understanding, this is a form of violation that took place to this particular individual based on overexposure to particular forms of narratives about conflict. This brings me also to my own experience, which is basically, a lot of the time, there is a feeling that activists are do-gooders, and therefore that they are resilient to all sorts of things. But what we don't understand is what's happening to the activists while they're going through those experiences. At a personal level, having worked on these issues, I mean, talked to former combatants, to victims, government officials, what happened was that I realized that I started looking out for extremely gruesome stories in order to demonstrate certain things. And that was a subconscious process that was going on. But at the same time, I personally started coping with the situation slightly differently from how other people would normally cope with terrible situations. And my response to that, which is the last point, was to simply quit the job and start doing something else. I thank you very much.
Be back after her class and around for the rest of the conference. So if anyone has direct questions for her, she will be available in a little bit. But we can open the floor for questions to the rest of the panel now. Yes, please.
Hi. Thank you very much. This has been a fascinating start to the conference. I have a question both for Dr. Martinez and Mr. Ocello, really. You both mentioned the significance of using visual imagery to communicate with an illiterate population. The question I have is, how do you deal with contextualizing imagery when you are presenting it to people that can't read, in essence, even the text underneath to give context to the image? It seems like there is scope there for misinterpretation or indeed like a deliberate casting of information in particular ways in order to put a point across. I wonder how that has come up in your work.
Okay. All right. Thank you for the question. Actually, that's a very good one. As we all know, these official or official versions produced with photographs are manipulated. It's a construction that has been done by the TRC in the case of Peru, You could place the images in totally different ways and narrate a totally different story. So there is a purpose behind, right, by the TRC and the state, the Peruvian state. When presenting to illiterate populations, that has been problematic, and that's one of the criticisms to the TRC, to the organization of that imagery. Nevertheless, most of the time, the itinerant exhibitions go out with people from NGOs or are sick by people from NGOs that work with indigenous populations. And they do provide information beforehand. They talk to the communities about the what happened in Peru. Some people in those communities are aware because they have family who were disappeared. Right, so they have an awareness of that, but I think that we need to do more study, or people who study how people react, you know, the affect part of the imagery when showing that to populations that are not reflecting on the text but just the images. There are a lot of things on YouTube, as I was saying at the end of the talk. A lot of people are going to the exhibit, looking, and then placing their comments on YouTube and taking selfies, basically, with images there to discuss the topic. So I think that we need to do more study about that and see what is the impact within those communities. And I don't think the state is doing it, which is highly problematic. Yeah.
No, I totally agree with the perspective that has just been presented, but I also think the question is an extremely important one. And I suppose you are reacting to one of the slides over there that had English translations under it.
Yeah.
With respect to the ones in northern Uganda, first of all, I spoke the language. I was from the community, so there was no way that that process could be manipulated. But I also had been a researcher for quite a substantive period of time, so my ethical responsibilities were very highly honed by that point in time. So the point about manipulation couldn't come about. But at the same time, the text at the bottom did not detract from having the person speak for themselves. So if you contested the text, you go with the voice. Because, you know, they were actually talking for themselves. We only translated for the English audience what was going on. But I think, I mean, underlying your question is also the very question of how do you start these conversations? The issue of the rape against the rape of men that I referred to, we did not go looking out for it. We merely went to a community and asked, "What has been the relationship between your community and the National Army?" That was the question that was asked, and of course, people said all sorts of things until one of the gentlemen in the community stood up and started saying, "Okay, let's not gloss over this. X, Y, Z happened to me." And from a Western sort of perspective, you can understand what that means from an ethical perspective. If somebody stands in a community and starts talking about their own experiences, well knowing the dangers that could come with it, you shut them down. But this particular individual was quite interesting in the sense that having talked, we pursued him and had a deeper conversation about it. But in the course of having that conversation, he insisted that this video had to be brought back to the community. So having put it together, we came back and showed it to him and said, "This is what it looks like. Are you really sure you want this happening in the community?" And he said, "Not only do I want it shown to the community, I actually want it to happen in my homestead so that everybody is aware about what happened to me." And that's how this whole conversation evolved. For those of you who might have seen, that conversation has also shifted completely the understanding of gender. There's a video out there that we did as a follow-up and used this man's story entitled Gender Against Men. And just the point being to demonstrate how the current work on gender is merely about using a sledgehammer to nail a pin, whereas gender, as we understand it, but long story short, there are certain safeguards that were put in place in order to ensure that people are not violated.
Comments. I mean, I have a few comments, if you allow. I think that I'm Egyptian, I live in South Africa, so I like to talk about Middle East, North Africa, and South Africa. I think there is an issue about visualization, that the idea of social distance. Most of the time, people watching or viewing these photographs, they tend to sort of re-emphasize stereotypes, and less about how people are and how they are different in many ways. Another thing is, because again, I speak about Middle East, North Africa, and South Africa, who sets the agenda? Who has an access to visualization? Who has the idea, the authority to, let's say, allow it available on YouTube? Who has, you know what I mean? These kinds of issues, maybe it sounds stupid for other people, but in a region that is mostly uneducated, most of the time have no digital literacy. So those in authority, in power, or those who have money or elite, so at the end of the day, does it really reflect what is happening, all the viewpoints that's supposed to be happening with? Another thing is the idea of orality. Most of the time in our regions, in Africa and Middle East, North Africa, it's a group thing. So it's like this kind of group pressure, watching and interpreting things. So even if you tell me whatever, there are still, in South Africa, people still vote based on color and race. So you can tell me whatever you want, but if at the end of the day, to what extent this can change my behavior in respect to things? And just, sorry for taking your time, one of the examples I would say, evident and completely disregarded by many people, the pictures of Abu Ghraib. Most of the time people compete for scoop, and less people studying the impact of exposing those males and females who are subject to rape or harassment, etc., the honor killing, the committing suicide, so on. So most of the time, it sounds very flashy, but it has many intriguing problems that are very, I would say, domestically specific problems that entail many things in, and the stigma. In South Africa today, until today, 2016, people prefer not to take any medicine and walk for 5-6 kilometers in rural areas so that people do not know that they have. You know what I mean? So within this context, visualization is very tricky. And most of the time, it's in the hands of authorities or hands of people who want to, let's say, cash out of the dilemma that's going through. Sorry for taking your time.
Does anybody want to respond to that?
I totally agree with you, Ibrahim. And I would like to reiterate, you know, like in the Peruvian case, and I think in most cases when we see issues of, you know, of TRCs that are using images, especially now with that we have more access to technology, I think that there is a construction, and with construction comes manipulation. I mean, we cannot be naive about that. On the other hand, if you don't do anything and you silence all of that because you are afraid of showing to the nation what took place, then it becomes also problematic. In the Peruvian case, because most of the work took place in rural areas that were totally abandoned by the state, and people in Lima, particularly in the capital, were aware about the war, obviously, because at some point it hit the capital, and that's when they began paying attention, after they killed journalists from the capital, and then when it hit the capital, which was years after the war began. So most people, the average middle class, upper class Peruvian, didn't want to hear about the war, and they were ignoring, and they thought, well, it's a group of crazy communists who one day will disappear. Well, 20 years later, they were not disappearing, and they have killed 70,000 people between the army, the state forces, and the Communist Party. So I think that despite all the, you know, all the problems that you may have when you construct these discourses, it's very important for a nation to see what took place, especially for newer generations. I mean, I'm thinking of young people, you know, my nephews and nieces who are now 17, 18, they didn't go through the war. They have no clue. And they think that, oh, yeah, well, that was only in some areas of Peru. Well, it took over the country, right? So I think that it's highly problematic to create these discourses. But at the same time, if you don't do it, you are risking to repeat this story, which in Latin America it's an issue. You see Chile, Peru, Argentina, all the dirty wars, Central America, that we really need to do something about it. And people are now using new technologies to give their own versions. And that's what I had to rush at the end, but I wanted to talk a little bit about that, how people are using these images as a point of departure to discuss their own experiences as Peruvians who went through the war and as Peruvians who never experienced the war and are learning about it. And if you go to YouTube and you put Yuyanapac, you'll get like thousands and with different discourses, you know, including that one of young people who are now enlisting in the new semi-official Shining Path movement, which is attempting to become an official party. Which, you know, when you have a poor country, and probably it's the same in other poor nations around the world, if the structural issues are not solved, you are always going to have turmoil. So, yeah.
I was just going to say, of course, and I think what's come really interesting is the kind of ways in which sexual violence in particular, Moses's point, his example was compelling in the same way that I was trying to think about, that it does something in terms of, it kind of averts our gaze in ongoing ways, not just about the moment. But there's some, and I think the strategies that my colleagues are trying to talk about here are kind of new ways for thinking about how to ask people to think about this problem, which can't be easily visualized. And I think the video that you're suggesting is incredibly, incredibly powerful for that. And then there's some sort of suture that's much, much more unconscious than the kind of formal ways in which human rights are talked about sexuality and forms of power, that in a country that there is this incredible repression of homosexuality, for example, that you'd have this particular kind of violence emerge. Those kinds of questions are interesting.
I wanted to pose a question that follows up with what you said about images and whether or not, sorry, did it turn off? Images and whether or not they seem to have an impact based on how gruesome or tragic they are, and the Abu Ghraib photographs are example. And I myself work with Muslim youth. I've done an ethnography with youth in Lahore and New York City, and they're very much impassioned by the photographs that come out from Muslim countries and then are very disenchanted with the reaction that happens, of course. So kind of echoing this feeling. And so I wanted to ask the panelists about audience and thinking about what kinds of audiences, because I think that's a really important part of how photographs or visuals are interpreted and how they subsequently are taken up in other conversations. And I think each paper talks about it in a very different way, so perhaps we could talk a little bit about audience and purpose.
The case that I brought was unique in that it's human rights, so it's a third-party organization intervening upon a Canadian story. This is a conversation that's still not being had in Canada, but it seems remarkable. I know there's sort of some stereotypes about Canada is that, you know, we're a good and happy place. What was interesting too in the context of the, I'm just slightly refashioning your question, about the way in which it was interesting how the panelists lined up in a way that each of us are sort of somehow subjectively caught in the narrative. I think some of you spoke about it more openly, and I'm not sure about Deborah, but I'm going to guess that she has ties to the Caribbean. And so there's a way in which there's a kind of subtle play in each of the papers, I think, that's about how to think about one's own sets of problems. And then you turned it again at the end of your paper to think about the impact. So in other words, the question of the audience is also one for ourselves. Like how to work through the narratives that are our histories. I don't have an answer to your question.
Yeah, I mean, again, you raise a very important question. One of the things that I wanted to talk about that I didn't was just how do you use some of these videos, some of these exhibitions, once you've gotten them. And we knew we were treading on extremely dangerous territory. You could get killed at the time. for doing this sort of work. But we knew that we were also doing work that the government is aware about. So one of the screenings that we had to do, again, this relates to the rape of men, was to get the army commanders into a room, mix them up with diplomats, because we were trying to kind of balance it all out. Mix them up with diplomats. The diplomats were in there only to protect us. But the videos that we're showing included both men who have been raped and men who are involved in raping their fellow citizens. And so there was information coming out about particular battalions that were involved in this. And then the army commanders who operated in that area were being challenged to respond. And interestingly, by going about that, they started acknowledging that some errand, you know how it goes always, it could have been isolated incident and stuff like that, but the, you know, the perpetrator is saying it was a policy. And even if the men who were involved in the rape did not want to do so, they were compelled by virtue of their military obligations to rape. And they were saying this also to the, they were saying this to the video. But I think the other interesting dimension to it is just moving from the politicians and the bureaucrats to the communities, because as you will know from Peru and all of these other places, this is often a process of silencing whole nations, not just the immediate victims. A narrative is created that is not allowed to be out there. So then you have to compete with the bureaucrats to make this a public issue. So then we organized a national tours to have a conversation about some of these issues, because at the time the narrative that had been created had effectively divided Uganda into two geographical regions, one where the theater of conflict was and one that was not allowed to know. So the region that was not allowed to know was exposed to these images, and they started asking questions and saying, really, is this true? So the next thing then, I mean, this is a whole advocacy package that you have to be involved in. The next thing then was about, okay, if you really want to hear this for yourself, instead of dealing with a video, we can transport you to those communities. So you engage either as elders. So it's a very complex issue. To wind up on the question that you raised, I think there are very many different techniques of going about creating visual images. One of them could involve just people talking by themselves. There was a particular character that had shadowed me for quite a while, having heard some of the work that we're doing, and he wanted to tell his story. And all that I did was to say, okay, if I provided you with a camera, are you willing to talk to it? Say whatever you want to talk, you know, to say to it. And every day I reviewed, you know, so many hours of video and saying, you mentioned X, Y, Z, can you elaborate on that? Can you elaborate on, you know? So it created a very powerful personal story, which at the time was over 50 hours. Now, how do you challenge that? If he's mentioning dates, times, and nobody's questioning him, it's just a narrative that he elaborates on over a period of time. And the last one is the sources are also historical. If you went to military archives, if you went to TV station archives and the like, you're going to find amazing footage in there about a whole period in a country that in itself is irrefutable. So it really depends on how you mix and match the different techniques to kind of create a much more balanced narrative. But that's, of course, understandably very difficult.
I guess just kind of following up on the same idea of audience, I was wondering if in the last 5 minutes, if each of you could maybe touch on the idea of compassion and how that factors into, you know, whether or not we're trying to realize some kind of tangible results from the visuals that you've collected and researched, and how that maybe can invoke some kind of compassion within the audiences who are viewing them.
I think that's a really good question, because usually we don't tend to think about that when we are looking at these issues. But This past summer, I was working in Peru. I go there every year because my mother is still alive. She's 90 and lives in Peru, so I go to see her and do some work. And I talk with a young writer who's a historian that was part, as part of his dissertation, he worked with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And now he's one of the most young, prominent historians of memory in Peru. And he has produced a book that it's really, really amazing, I think, very humane and talking about compassion. It's called Los Rendidos, El Don de Perdonar, The Surrenders, The Gift of Forgiveness. And the beautiful history and story with him is that his parents, he was 12 when the war was going on, so he grew up with the war. His parents were part of the Shining Path, and they both were killed. His father was killed when this historian was 15, and the mother when he was about 19 or 20. So I interview him and I talk with him, and he was talking about the fact that there are a lot of histories and stories that are silenced, right? Because the official narrative in UNAP and everything is that the Shining Path really did 60 or 70% of the damage, right? You know, if you compare to other Latin American countries, here the Communist Party is really the one that basically created disappearances and killings. Compare quantitatively to what the army and other state forces did. So he talks a lot about that issue of compassion and forgiveness and the silencing of the next generation, of the children of people who fought in that war, whether you were, you know, the children of the military, of the soldiers, or the children of people in the different group, armed groups that were struggling against the state. And how can we talk about transitional justice and reconciliation if we are not willing to forgive both or all the sides, because there is not just one side, there are multiple players. And that's something that we need to begin thinking about. I think we have been spending a lot of time thinking about what happened, but not how can we deal with that in the present moment and move forward, forgiving all the parties involved, in educating the next generation about the evils of society, right, and the ailments of society that could lead us into another situation similar to that from 20 years ago. So I think compassion and forgiveness is a key element for reconciliation and reparation for societies, and that we really have to, as intellectuals or filmmakers, we have to start thinking about that and putting that into our work and not just being critical of discourses, but how do we move forward the conversation? So I appreciate your question. Yeah.
All right, last question? Yes, okay.
Hi, thank you all for your work. My question's for Sharon. I share your interest in the kind of, what I'm hearing as the radical potential of a kind of provocative memory object that you know, we can use imagination around. And so I want to ask you a question that I get asked in my own work around that kind of thing, which is, what are the limits of imagination? So if we're saying that imagination is a useful tool that gets us away from a figurative rendering of violence, what prevents people from filling in that empty space with like stereotypes or, you know, the images that we already have maybe about what sexual violence is or what it looks like, or particularly when you're talking about historically marginalized groups?
Yeah, that's a great question. In a purely theoretical sense, there's a difference between thinking about imagination in the Kantian sense, the capacity to imagine, the psychological mechanism, and the way that something like psychoanalysis would talk about fantasy, which is sort of a creation of a scene that's infused with desire. When we're talking about sexual violence, those are really fuzzy boundaries. I don't I mean, I can see the danger and where people are going to go to this. I mean, I happen to be on the side of someone like Kara Walker. Do you know Kara Walker's work at the American Artist, where she sort of invites us into the racist imagination as a kind of mode of making the repressed available to be thought. So I'm not worried, I don't think, at all about what comes to people's minds in this process. And in fact, I think we have several examples in the panel today, not just the one I talked about, but where that is incredibly important political work, partly because of the nature of the state is to repress what has happened. So we have to kind of use what tools we have to respond. And the question of compassion is so interesting, and there's such a complex debate, in particular around the Holocaust, where you know people like Derrida, or for that matter, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, people getting their backs up about the question of forgiveness. Whether we want to talk about compassion as a question of forgiveness is one question. Whether we want to define compassion as a kind of capacity to suffer with, that's, I guess, the Latin way of thinking about it, the notion of compassion as co-suffering. It's another question. I liked the way that Deborah talked about it, in the sense of thinking about the nature of what repair might be, and that there's a kind of asymmetry in dealing with forms of historical violence, to think about that in the case, especially in settler colonial countries like Canada, like Jamaica, like Peru, like most of Africa, maybe not a little bit differently, I suppose, that you have to be careful about the position you're taking in that question of compassion.
All right, well, thank you so much to the audience and to the panelists and the wonderful papers we heard this morning. I think there's a break now, right, Sandra? And then we'll return for the next panel. Thank you so much. Thank you. It's wonderful.